Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. The Son of God chose to spend the night at Peter's house, and when he saw that his disciple's mother-in-law was sick in bed, the God-man healed her instantly. Word spread and people brought their sick for a healing touch. Some expressed a desire to travel with Jesus, but nothing came of it because they didn't want to fully commit. The God-man fell asleep when the group sailed to the eastern side of the Sea of Galilee. A sudden storm threatened their safety, but Jesus woke up and commanded the winds to be calm, and the disciples were left wondering who this guy really was. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
So praise the Lord and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church Worldwide. And this is our last Sunday in the month of June. And I'm going to be preaching today about an eagle or a turkey. And let's pray right now. My Heavenly Father, I want to thank you and I want to praise you right now. That Lord, you're going to help me with this message. Father God, it's going to flow for me, and that, Lord, I will be able to present it in such a way that it will bring glory to you. It will be uplifting for the people listening, and that your kingdom shall be enlarged. And this I ask in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You had a little map up there to your right corner of the Lake of Galilee, and the cities around there. And we're going to be today in the city of Capernaum. That's the city of Capernaum. And that city was located in the north side of the Sea of Galilee between Gennesaret to the south and Chorus into the north. It was a Roman garrison town, and that is why Jesus encountered a centurion. It was also an administration center for the outlying area, with a custom station for the people that travel on the road snaking along the Sea of Galilee. Now, the Apostle Peter and Andrew were born and raised in Capernaum, as was the Apostle Matthew, or Levi, as he also was known. And Levi, or Matthew, was a manager of the tax department at Capernaum. The God-fearing centurion that we talked about last week was responsible for financing the construction of a synagogue in Capernaum. After Jesus had healed the leper and the slave of the centurion, he lodged in the home of Peter. Once inside, he discovered Peter's mother-in-law was sick and lay in bed. No one asked for the healing. The God-man just walked over and touched her. So let's turn to Matthew 8:15. That's the Gospel of Matthew, verses 8 and 15. I'm going to read verse 14 and 15. I started in 14. And when Jesus was coming to Peter's house, he saw his wife's mother, as his mother-in-law, laid and sick of fever. And he touched her hand, and the fever left her, and she arose and ministered unto them. We don't know how sick this woman was, but the Bible tells us this, that the moment Jesus spoke and touched her, she was instantly healed. She got up and she was part of preparing the food. Jesus came with the disciples, a lot of people there. It's a lot of work. So what we want to learn from this is this. Jesus can heal you instantly. There can be a waiting period before your healing comes. So, how do you do things? Now, we prayed last week for Paula's wrist. I told her to raise her hand up, and she said nothing happened. Why is that? It is not that Jesus does not want to heal it. There's some kind of a block, or Jesus is simply saying, I will, but not right now. I think that we can pretty much determine how it will happen. And I'm thinking about in my personal life, I have had healings many, many times. And when I press in and I simply say in the name of Jesus, I want this now. I need this now. I need to walk on the water now. God will give it to us. So we need to press in and start thanking God that something is happening. In verses 16 and 17 of the same chapter, when evening was come, they brought unto him many that were possessed with devils. And he cast out the spirits with his word, and he healed all that were sick, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities, and he bare our sicknesses. So when we talk about healing now, remember this. Before Jesus was crucified, he was beaten with 39 lashes. As Jesus was bent over, tied to a pole, he took it off his clothes, and he started whipping him from the neck down to his heels, where his whole body was bruised. It was a long whip, so they would go around and they would rip it back, so they would rip the front and the back. At that moment, every disease from Adam and Eve to the last person going to live on this earth was laid upon the body of Jesus. Jesus was the sickest man that ever existed on this earth. When he left Pilate's palace and they forced him to walk up to Golgotha, he was so weak he couldn't carry the crossbeam, so they had Simon of Cyrene carry it. So our healing has been paid for. There's a price for it. So if you understand that, you and I don't have to pray for it. Now, when we do stupid things, we pray for it. We many times cause sickness in our bodies. Eating the wrong food. Eating a lot of junk food. Not eating at all. Being sloppy with the meals. And then we get sick. But even then, we can repent and ask Jesus to forgive us and give me another chance. In Isaiah, let's just flip here, keep your fingers there and turn to Isaiah chapter 53. And Isaiah wrote this 700 years before Christ. That's Isaiah 53 and verses 4 and 5. This is what the prophet said, and this was given to him by the Holy Spirit. Surely he has borne our griefs, carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. So remember this. On the cross, Jesus paid for our sins. In the palace of Pilate, he paid for our sicknesses. And then the sicknesses were put upon him. He carried all the sicknesses up on the cross. And there is where he paid for our sins. So we read again verse number 17. That it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and he bare our sicknesses. If you read the book of Acts, you will find that there was constant healings. When there was a need, they prayed for the sick, and the sick got well. They got healed. So the normalcy for a Christian church should be this. If people are sick, we pray for them. If people are demonized, we pray for them. And we expect results. Let's go back to the outline now. Leaving Capernaum. Matthew doesn't tell us when Jesus left the home of Peter. But I would guess it would be in the morning or the next day, since traveling at night was difficult. Jesus could have easily stayed in Capernaum for a while to heal people and cast out demons. But he told his disciples he wanted to leave the city when he saw a huge crowd and walked to the shore of the Sea of Galilee with the intention of crossing over to the eastern side. Matthew 8:18. Now when Jesus saw great multitudes about him, he gave commandment to depart unto the other side. I want you to see this now. Jesus could have stayed in Capernaum for about 2-3 weeks. There were that many sick people. But Jesus would not come down just to do miracles. The miracles is a bonus for us. He came down to set the stage to pay for our sins and to save the human race. So various people approached Jesus and asked him questions. Picture this now. Here's Jesus walking down the road. You can see the map here from Capernaum. He's walking down to the Lake of Galilee. It probably took him a half a day or so. As he's walking down, there's a lot of people around him, and they go talking and so on, and some of them are happy. And then suddenly, a guy comes up to Jesus and just simply says, he just presses himself in close to Jesus and say, hey, Jesus, I got a question for you. And we read it. And a certain scribe came and said to him, Master, I will follow you whithersoever you go. Now, Jesus didn't slow down. He just kept walking. But here's what he said. The foxes have holes, the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has not where to lay his head. What happened to the scribe? Matthew doesn't tell that, but most likely when the scribe heard that, he said, thank you, Jesus. And he kind of peeled off in the crowd and simply said, I'm not going to follow him. He's homeless. I don't like that. So that man took off. That's all that's mentioned about him. We don't even have a name. He just disappeared. Another guy came up, and we read 9, verse number 20, and in verse number 21. And another of his disciples said to him, Lord, suffer me first to go and bury my father. But Jesus said to him, follow you me and let the dead bury the dead. Now you might think that's a harsh statement, but the custom in Judea, Galilee, that time was that the son, the oldest son, would not leave the house until dad and mom had passed away. He took care of them, and then he couldn't do things. So this guy came up and said, you know, I want to go with you, but, you know, I got to go home first, and when dad is dead, you know, I'll come back. And Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. Follow me. So, what did we learn of that? We learned this, that when Jesus calls you into ministry, he calls you. Jesus does not call you one day and say, I want you to be an apostle, I want you to be a disciple, I want you to be a pastor, whatever it is, or missionary. And you said, okay. And then, 6 months later, a year later, whatever it is, things are not going too well. And the person says, oh, it's too hard for me, I'm going to peel off. It doesn't work that way. God does not make mistakes. He simply, if he calls you, that calling is good until you leave this earth. Or he gives you a different assignment. I started out as a Sunday school teacher. I became a Sunday school superintendent. Then I started preaching for the Gideons. Then I became a seminary student. Then I became an evangelist. Then I became a pastor. I gone through different stages, but I'm still in the ministry. So when God calls you, you might be shifted, but you don't leave the ministry. One thing God told me after I finished seminary, you can never again hold a job outside the ministry. I want you full time. And there were times I was tempted, you know, I could get a little side job or do this and that, get a little money. But I knew this. I'm not supposed to. So let's go to this next page on the outline. So we come down here to getting into the ship. And we're going to switch over here now to Luke 8:22. So we're going to flip now to Luke 8:22. And my fingers are like butter today. Okay, Luke 8, and we're going to go to verse number 22. Now it came to pass on a certain day that he went into a ship with his disciples, and he said unto them, let us go over unto the other side of the lake. And they launched four. The Lake of Galilee is very peculiar. You can be on a lake and in less than 30 seconds, the lake is in a wild storm. And the reason for that is that you have a temperature difference between the bottom of the lake, surface of the lake, and the mountains. And a wind can come up. It runs down the side of the mountain just like you have in a canyon. If you've been in a canyon, the wind can be pretty ferocious in a canyon. And when it hits the water, it's shallow, and it really stirs it up. So you can be sitting in a calm area, and in 10 seconds, you are in a tremendous storm. So, we go down now to Matthew 8:24. So keep your finger in Luke, and we work between them here. In 8:24, we read this. And behold, arose a great tempest in the sea, so much that the ship was covered with its waves. But he, Jesus, was asleep. And in 8:23 we read, but as they sailed, he fell asleep, and there came down a storm of wind on the lake, and they were filled with water and were in jeopardy. So Jesus, now, if you understand healing, when you stand in a healing line and you have been praying for hundreds and hundreds of people, you are tired. So Jesus got in the ship, he laid down, and he was gone. And he was secure. Jesus knew that the Lake of Galilee could flare up at any time. But he simply was very, very secure. Now, under the storm here, it says, the Bible does not reveal if the storm was caused by natural or if Satan did this. The storms of the Sea of Galilee do not usually come with a cloud cover, as in most parts of the world. The sun can be shining brightly, and then sudden winds blow the waves, so the white cap could be seen like a boiling cauldron. Thus it was impossible for even the most seasoned fishermen to know in advance when the storm would arrive. Everyone living around the Sea of Galilee was familiar with the sudden storms. In Matthew 8:25, we pick this up here. And the disciples came to him and awoke him, saying, Lord, save us, we perish. Now, Jesus did not, I'm trying to find the paper here. Jesus didn't rebuke the disciples. He simply didn't. He did correct them. And he simply said, you know, where in the world is your faith? So look in Matthew 26 and 27. And Jesus said unto them, why are you fearful, O you of little faith? Then he arose, rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. But the men marveled, saying, what manner of man is this, that even the winds and the sea obey him? Let's see what Luke says in 8:25. And he said to them, where is your faith? And they being afraid, wondered, saying one to another, what manner of man is this? For he commanded even the winds and the water, and they obeyed. This is something that we can use during the time of the tribulation, when we're going to be having to rely upon miracles. How did God do that miracle? How did Jesus do it? He just simply stood up and said, you know, quiet. Knock it off. I want you to think of something. But God created this earth. He not just simply made a ball. It's much designed. You got under the surface, you got rivers, you got springs, You got water. You got metals. We got ore. You got iron, gold, silver. There's all kind of things. The earth is extremely well created. It is not just a bunch of material. And so that took a lot of effort. Angels have equipment that you and I cannot even dream of. There were angels watching Jesus. And when Jesus spoke, the angels activated whatever piece of machinery they have. And they simply crushed the winds immediately. It stopped. You might differ with me on this. But here's what I believe. For years, I just read, you know, that Jesus did a miracle here, a miracle there. I never thought about it. It was like, you know, magician, you know. He just said a word, you know, and boom, it happened. I don't believe that it is magic. I believe that Jesus worked with these angels. He worked with the Holy Spirit. And they were simply working from the spirit world into the physical world. They go back and forth. And if you understand that, then this will happen to us today. So when we pray, we are simply asking God to have angels come in for the spirit world and begin to do things in our physical world. We have the Holy Spirit coming in. So if you understand that, it is not just magic. You don't like you have a wand and you do like this and things happen. No, it's a reality. The spirit world is real. There's power. There's things happening. They have equipment. To us, it looks like a miracle. If you would, I'm not going to read about from Exodus 14 and 12. But yes, I am. So keep your finger there in Matthew, and we could go back to Exodus. And that's a fine book of Exodus. I've been there before. Chapter 14. Getting closer. 16. And verses 21. And Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind all that night, and made the sea dry land, and the waters were divided. That was a miracle to Moses and the people. To Jesus, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, it was simply something they could do from the spirit world. They had power to do that. They can do things like that. The Bible says that God rebuked, but it was a refurbishing. He rebuked the mountains. And they went down, and the ocean floors came up, and the mountains went down. So we are going, we living on the land that used to be the ocean bottom. And the ocean bottom used to be dry land. Now, people say that that's not really possible. I said it before, you go up to the mountains, you find fossils of fish, lobsters, all kind of things, which indicate that that area once was underwater. God can do it. Nothing is impossible for God. God can stop a freight train in the name of Jesus if it happens to be that you're on a by chance you have got on the track and the train is coming down. I believe you can put your hands up and say in the name of Jesus, stop. And God will have angels coming down and they will simply take that train and just stop it. Nothing is impossible for God. It is our faith. So let's go back now to Matthew. We're going to look at Matthew 26:53. That's Matthew 26:53. So, Matthew 26:53. Jesus said this, don't you think that I cannot pray to my Father? He shall presently give me more than 12 legions of angels. That's 72,000 angels. He was not going to be crucified. And he said, you know, I can get out of this if I want to. I got 72,000 angels. They're just watching me. And all I have to do is just do my finger like this and they come down. They kill off everyone here, they take me out of here, and I'm done with you. But he didn't do it. So, this type of thinking, now back on the outline, brings to a challenge. Jesus stated that anyone who's born again would be able to duplicate the same miracles Jesus did. And now we go to John chapter 14. That's the Gospel of John, the 14th chapter. And we're going to pick it up in verses 11 through 14. Believe me that I'm in the Father, and the Father in me. Whereas believe me for the very work's sake. Verily, verily, said to you, he that believes on me, the works that I do shall he do also. Greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And whatsoever you shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. If you love me, keep my commandments. We've read that many times. What does it mean? It simply means this. Verily have I said to you, he that believes on me, that's you and me, the works that I do shall he do also. In other words, we're going to do the works of Jesus and we're going to do greater works than Jesus. Let me tell you how crazy they were in the seminary when I brought this up. They simply said this. We don't need miracles today. We got radio, television. We got, at that time, we didn't have the internet. And we got airplanes and so on. We don't need the miracles. So we're going to do greater works than Jesus did because we have a greater technology. Let me run through the Brian again. They said, because... This is not 1969-70. Because we have a greater technology than what Jesus had when he was here, we can do more work than Jesus could because we got the technology. There was no mention of supernatural stuff. It was all natural. Now you teach that to pastors in the seminary, and these guys are going to come out, and they're going to repeat what they are told. And the people in the congregation are going to listen to the pastor that says, well, he's been to seminary. He probably knows more than I do, you know. So if he says so, you know, that's the way it is. That's how you spread a lie. Now, let's go back again to John 14. Because now, how do we do this kind of work? It can only be done through the Holy Spirit. Let's go down to verse number 16 and 17 here. And I will pray the Father, he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom your Father cannot receive, because it sees him not, neither knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless, I will come to you. It takes the Holy Spirit to do miracles. Now, how do you activate the Holy Spirit? You don't activate him. He activates you. But you have to invite him into your life. If you don't invite him, he's not going to come into your life. So, in a seminary, and that's what I teach in all the different learning institutions, the Holy Spirit is no longer here. All the miracles that we had in the book of Acts, that was for that time only. They got the Bible. And since we got the Bible, we don't need any miracles. We don't need a power. Take the Bible and throw it at the devil. Take the Bible. They don't believe in demons. It simply is total insanity. It will be like the U.S. Army make a decision. We no longer believe in ammunition. We're going to give our troops the finest rifles, assault weapons. We're going to give them guns. We're going to give them tanks and so on. We're going to give them everything. But no ammunition. Because we don't need ammunition anymore. Our cripples are so good. What good is a rifle if you got no bullets? You can use it as a club. That's about it. And that's exactly what Satan has done for the German theologians beginning in the early 1800s when they simply removed the Holy Spirit. And today, believers in Christ, they have the rifle, but they don't have any bullets because we are told they don't exist anymore. In Hebrews chapter 1, we get there fairly quick. Hebrews chapter 1 and the last two verses, 13 and 14. But to which of the angels said he at any time, sit on my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool? Are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for them who shall be heirs of salvation? The angels are here to help us, to assist us. I'm talking about holy angels now. I never forget this, and I've said it many times. I'm on the Autobahn in Germany, doing 80 miles an hour, going a pass, it's a two-lane freeway, passing a truck. And just as I'm coming up to his rear end, I'm just about coming up to the truck, I see his left front wheel rolling over the road. and I know that. He lost the wheel. That guy's going to crash. Split second in my head. I saw the wheel. Everybody, we were about 12 people in the van. All I heard was everybody started calling on Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Because they knew we were doing 80 miles an hour. That truck would land on us. We'd be smashed. I watched the front of that truck lifted up and running straight with no wheel as we were able to shoot through, shoot about past him. And I was no more than 10, 15 feet away from him when that thing crashed and rolled over the whole freeway. Who did that? God had angels. There was an angel came down and simply held that truck up until we passed and then said, okay, let it go. And it crashed. Let me go back here to the outline on page 3. Jesus had the disciples to perform miracles in his name before the crucifixion and subsequent resurrection. So we turn to Luke chapter 10. That's the Gospel of Luke chapter 10. Almost there. Here we go. Luke chapter 10 and verses 17 to 21. And the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject to us through your name. Let me read it again. And the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through your name. And Jesus said to them, I beheld Satan and lightning fall from heaven. Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions, over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Notwithstanding this, rejoice not that the spirits are subject to you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. We don't rejoice in that. We rejoice in our salvation. But we have that power available to us. Verse 21. In that hour, Jesus rejoiced in spirit and said, I thank you, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hid these things from the wise and prudent, have revealed them unto the babes, even so, Father, for so it seemed good in your sight. There is power. Let me tell you of a small miracle that took place in the 70s in a tent meeting in Sweden. When you have a tent like that, you got poles that go up and they go through. So you have a hole, it's a little ring there, you have the hole. And we were sitting in there, I was sitting next to Ina, and there was a hornet that was just swirling around. Matter of fact, I was preaching. He was swirling around the pulpit. You know, you have it, and you go like that. You know, you fall. And so, Ina simply put a finger up and said, in the name of Jesus, hornet, get out through that hole right now. That thing flew straight out. Now, people say, you know, that's ridiculous. No. Small things. God will do things with you. I'll never forget the first time I got back to Sweden, 1971. My brother Peter loaned me his car because we didn't have a car then. And so I drove around, and for some reason, something got loose in the heater compartment, and it went clunk, and the heater didn't work. So I drove back to the house, and I said, Peter, I said, something went wrong with your heater. He looked at me, cold eyes, and said, since you drove the car, you fix it. I said, but it's your car. I just had it for a couple of minutes. Since you drove it, you fix it. I didn't have any tools. So I was sitting there, and I was simply bewildered. And I put my hands on the little compartment. I said, Jesus, I need a miracle. Clunk! The thing went back where it should go. I turned on the heater. Worked fine. I said to Peter, car's fixed. Small things. I can stand here all day and tell you in everyday life how the Holy Spirit and angels intervene in my life. And that's what he wants for you. So the Son of God stipulated, we've read that many times, the disciples should not leave Jerusalem. He said, I don't want you to minister before you be baptized in the Holy Spirit. And the church was born in fire the day of Pentecost, second chapter of the book of Acts. And we know that. That was a miracle. Let me take you back. Matter of fact, let's turn to Acts chapter 2. Acts, the second chapter. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like the fire, and it set upon them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. Look at the situation. Jesus had been crucified. He died. He was resurrected. His body was resurrected on the third day. And then, after 40 days, he ascended up into heaven. The high priest was the same. Pilate was still there. All that what they have done, the matter of fact, the church people at that time, the 120, they were walking around, hiding, not making any noise. And they were simply intimidated. So on the day of Pentecost, 50 days after the Passover, also the crucifixion, they were sitting in the room, sitting there, Jesus was gone. Oh, what can happen? You know, they were powerless. And then suddenly, boom, the power came into that room. 120 people. The apostles, the 70s, 39 women. And when they were filled with the Holy Spirit, they suddenly got out on the streets. They had been given the gift of speaking other languages that they had never learned. And they spoke boldly about Jesus. And then later that day, Peter got up and preached boldly. 3,000 men accepted Christ that day. What changed them? The Holy Spirit. Let's do a summary right now. What is the expectation of miracles in the modern church? It is very low because the church as a whole is powerless. Hardly any evangelical pastor teach about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The doctrine being of miracles were only for the apostolic church. Ceased to exist with the last apostle. With this mindset and teaching, Is it any wonder that born-again believers in Christ have no faith that miracles are still possible? And we got a statement here. Most Christians can be likened to a fat farm turkey waddling around on the ground instead of soaring high like an eagle. The New Testament is full of miracles, signs, and wonders, but this supernatural inheritance has been stolen by Lucifer, and most Christians are like homeless beggars, hoping for something would happen possible. Now, I laid out something for you here today. So realize this now. This day did not go well for me. I did it NIP, and it worked out fine. Then I got the wrong sermon outline. I had studied that sermon outline this morning. I've not studied this one. I was fully prepared to deal with the demons. So here I am. And then I see staff back there, you know, hey, you're preaching next Sunday's message. I had to make a split second. First I got angry. Oh. And then I realized, I can either make something out of this, or I can have a disaster. So I simply said, okay, forget what I just said, give another outline. I started over. What I first preached today is going to be wiped out. It's not going to exist. How did I do that? Because the Holy Spirit simply said, you made a mistake, don't worry about it, kick in, do what you have. So if you understand that the Holy Spirit is always with you, and you begin to live in a supernatural, think about the spirit world, then things will begin to happen in your life. The question is, do you believe it? Remember what Jesus said to this one man? He said, as you have believed, so be it to you. So, my last statement today is simply this. Are you a fat turkey walking around on the farm? Or are you an eagle soaring, riding on the wind, and just having a good time? You make a decision. It is your decision to make. I cannot make it for you. If you, today, some of you are already soaring like eagles. But to those of you that are not, if you make a decision today and says, I know for years that church doctrine has been, there's no power, there's no Holy Spirit, there's no demons. But the Bible says there is, I'm going to believe the Bible. That's the first step. And you're going to be in for a fantastic ride. Because when you ride with the Holy Spirit, you're going places. And they are nice. Now, you watch me today. Again, you are there. You're not saved. You might have been there a couple of times, and you are still not saved. And you are saying, I'd like to get into the Christian life. You can. All you have to do is to say this. I'm a sinner. You know that. That's not news. I need to get saved. Father God, I believe that Jesus is your son. I believe he died on the cross, rose on the third day. He paid for my sins. He paid for my diseases. And I want to be saved. Come on in, Jesus. Come on in and save me. And Jesus will. After the final prayer here, the screen will change where you are. Three crosses will come up. And you will hear the voice of Pastor Charles saying, my friend. And he will take 10 minutes with you to talk to you about exactly how to get saved and pray with you. If you do that, you'll get saved. You'll get saved right now. Would you contact us after that? I'd like to pray with you. I'd like to rejoice with you. I'd like to know that you got saved. And to those of you that are walking with the Lord, you're in different stages. Think what I said here today. You saw my flip-flopping around. And decide this. I'm going to be moving in the Holy Spirit. Take this afternoon, go through the outline again, and really think about it and say, if it's good enough for Paul and Silas, it's good enough for me. I want it. And you can have a fantastic life, but you got to make a decision. And when you make the decision, ask God to forgive you for your unbelief all these years. And say, God, forgive me that I believed church doctrine instead of believing the Bible. And God will meet with you. And you're going to find out the Holy Spirit's going to come and really touch you. God bless you. Here's Thomas.
Father God, thank you for the word today, Lord. And we read the verse that you healed them with your word. We have the word available to us, and it is so much of a blessing to be able to dive into the word of God. Bible says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. So thank you, Father God, for your blessing upon those that took time to get into your Word today. And I also thank you for the work that's being done out there in the world as we celebrate Natural Families Month. And we promote the God-given, ordained family. Mother, father, children, repeat the process. I thank you for it. Thank you, Father, for the way you have blessed each and every one of us that have the mind of Christ. And I thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are. You've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person. Doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything? Even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever.
You have been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the 23rd part in the series, The Gospel of Matthew, and was entitled, Eagle or Turkey. The Son of God chose to spend the night at Peter's house. And when he saw that his disciple's mother-in-law was sick in bed, the God-man healed her instantly. Word spread and people brought their sick for a healing touch. Some expressed a desire to travel with Jesus, but nothing came of it because they didn't want to fully commit. The God-man fell asleep when the group sailed to the eastern side of the Sea of Galilee. A sudden storm threatened their safety, and when the winds died down immediately after Jesus commanded them to be calm, the disciples were left wondering who this guy really was. Are miracles a thing of the past? Modern Christianity would have you believe so, yet the New Testament is full of miracles, signs, and wonders. This supernatural inheritance has been stolen by Lucifer, and most Christians are like homeless beggars, hoping for something, but not really having faith that it will happen. The question remains, are you going to do something about it? This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1918. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.